So I tell you this, and insist on it in the Lord, that you must no longer live as Gentiles do in the futility of their thinking. They are darkened in their understanding and separated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them due to the hardening of their hearts. Having lost all sensitivity, they have given themselves over to sensuality so as to indulge in every kind of impurity, and they are full of greed. That, however, is not the way of life you learned. When you heard about Christ and were taught in him in accordance with the truth that is in Jesus, you were taught with regard to your former way of life, to put off your old self, which is being corrupted by its deceitful desires, to be made new in the attitude of your minds, and to put on the new self, created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness.
Thanks, Mike. If you can hear a hum, it's the metal plate in my head. I'm picking up FM, so. Well, good morning. It is good to see you all. Don't look out the windows, whatever you do. There's white stuff coming from the sky. Welcome to Michigan Spring. Well, we are in a passage this morning that we had started to look at, it seems 2 months ago, right before Laura and I went to Florida to collect our son that we adopted. And we have yet to get back into the book of Ephesians. So this morning, we are going to get back into the book of Ephesians. So this passage is a tricky passage. It's a little bit of a heavy passage. So let's turn our hearts towards our Creator. Let's ask him to do the speaking. Father in heaven, we are just amazed at your goodness, Lord. Amazed, Lord, that you would send your only son, Lord, that just by believing upon him, we would not perish but have eternal life. Lord, so many of us in this building, in this room this morning, know you in that manner. And Lord, I pray this morning that you would open our hearts and our minds to understand what it is that your word would share with us. Thinking about the snow outside, help us to reason together with you, Lord. Though our sins be as scarlet, they are and they will be as white as snow. Lord, we pray that you would speak to us now in Jesus' name. Amen. The Bible is an amazing book. If you've not come to that realization yet, I pray you will. 1 John 5:4. It's been a verse that's kind of been rattling around in my brain for about a week. But 1 John 5:4 says that whatsoever is born of God has overcome the world. In other words, whoever is born of God has overcome the world. John 3:5. Jesus said to Nicodemus, he says it to us as well, he says, you must be born again. In other words, you need spiritual DNA. This DNA that you have is not good enough to go to heaven. It's passing away. It's full of death and sin and decay. So I want you to have new spiritual DNA, Jesus says. You need to be born from above, born again. It's an amazing thing to be a born again Christian. John 16:33, and this is just an introduction. We will get into Ephesians. But John 16:33, right before Jesus goes to the cross, he's talking to his disciples. They're all a little bit confused about what's going on. They don't know what's happening as he's preparing them for his death, his burial, and his resurrection. And this is what he says. He says, in this world, you will have tribulation. You're going to get sick. You're going to have problems. You're going to have relational issues. You're going to suffer from depression, maybe panic attacks. There's going to be things happening in your life that you think, I'm a Christian, why me? In this world, you will have tribulation. But then he says this, be of good cheer, for I have overcome the world. There's that word again, overcome. Whatever is born of God, if you're born again, you have overcome the world. What actually happens the moment you become a Christian, the moment you place your faith in Christ, is that it's not so much that you are receiving Christ into your life, it's more that Christ is receiving you into his life. That's what we're going to get into this morning. This passage is dealing with this. That word for overcomer, that's the word Nike in the Greek. Anyone here ever had a pair of Nikes? When I was, I would say a kid, but I wasn't, okay. 10 years ago, I got a pair of Nikes in a thrift store, and they were Nike pumps. You know, you could... Problem was, the left foot didn't quite work well, and the right foot did. So I was like this. But man, you know, I was a Nike. I was, and you know that word? It means in the Greek, a winner, an overcomer. I felt like a winner. Now granted, when I ran, it would be in circles, you know, because of the left foot. But the passage that we're getting into this morning is dealing with overcoming. How do you overcome in a world full of sin and death? How do you overcome when even in your own flesh you do things wrong still? You say things wrong, you think things wrong, and we purposefully disobey God at times. That's what Paul is getting into. Be of good cheer, for I have overcome the world. This is what Jesus says. When we started out in the book of Ephesians, we started out with the first three chapters. We saw the wealth of the believer, all those things that God had done on your behalf by adopting you into his family. We read that, that you were chosen, Ephesians 1:3, adopted into his family, Ephesians 1:4, accepted in the beloved, Ephesians 1:6. You were redeemed by the blood of Christ, saved by grace, raised with Christ to be seated in the heavenly places. All those things happened in chapters 1 through 3. Those are things that Jesus himself did that you did not do yourself. You have a wealth in Christ. So everything that happened in chapters 1 through 3 happened on the inside of you. When you're born again, you're born from above, you're brand new. 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, if any man or any woman be in Christ, they are a new creation. The old has passed away, and behold, all things are new. You're a new creation. And that's what Ephesians chapters 1 through 3 deals with. This is what the new creation looks like. Now, we're in chapter 4, and as we pass through chapter 4 through 6, now it's going to do with what the outside of the Christian looks like and how it is to match up ultimately with what's going on the inside. All right, you ready for this? It's going to be a bumpy road, okay? So here we go. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 17. Says, this I insist, that you do not walk as the Gentiles walk in the futility of their mind. Paul is saying this on the heels of having mentioned all of the other stuff we just said. Guys, you're brand new. You're not who you think you are. You belong to Jesus. You belong to the God of the universe. Jesus is the one that created everything. John chapter 1, verse 2 and 3. Colossians 1, 10 through 13. Jesus is the creator of the world. And he created you. Revelation 4:11, he created you for his good pleasure. He wants relationship with you. And so in order to make that happen, he gave you a brand new creation. He made you completely new and fit for heaven on the inside. Now on the outside, you still have problems because you still have a body of sin and death. And so Paul is saying, guys, I insist on this. Don't walk like the Gentiles do in the futility of their minds. Now, a Gentile person is somebody who was not a Jew, somebody that did not believe in Yahweh, in God. And as we go on through this, we realize Paul's actually talking about anyone who is not a Christian, anyone that is not in a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. Anything outside of Christ is to be like one of those Gentiles. The Gentiles walked in the futility of their minds. And we touched on this when we looked at this 2 months ago. They walked aimlessly. The Greek word there means to just walk with no purpose. In fact, the word futility means to be empty-headed. Empty-headed. In other words, you can be the most successful person, have all the business connections, have a great reputation in the culture you live in. You can be very well established in this world. You can even be a good person, do great things. But if you don't have a relationship with Jesus Christ, it's all empty. No purpose. It's just meandering aimlessly. No eternal perspective. Not so for us, though, as Christians. If you have placed your faith in Christ, he changes everything. Now you have an eternal perspective, not just a temporal perspective. And the things that he wants to do through you are eternal. So don't walk like you used to before you met Jesus. Don't walk that way. Don't think with empty thoughts. Don't have temporal goals. Have eternal goals. Think with the light of eternity in every decision you make, and God will bless that decision. Now, from verses 17 down through verse 32, rest of this chapter, basically, Paul's going to give us a bit of a contrast between the old you and the new you, the old me and the new me, if you're a Christian. If you're not a Christian yet, you don't know Jesus personally, it's just the old you. There is no new you. But Paul wants to make it clear there is a new you, a new creation. That's the part of you that's eternal. That's the part that's in heaven when you go there. That's the part that is overcoming the world. So he kind of gives this contrast between the old and the new, much like a Jenny Craig commercial or a Weight Watchers commercial. You know, this is the before and this is the after. You know, so the after is always the guy with the big pants going, you know, or the, you know, look at me now. You do not know who you are necessarily because you still live in this world. And in this world, you will have tribulation. Sometimes we think with the old self. You know, I'm a little bit flabby spiritually. I don't feel good. I still say the wrong thing. I still kick the cat. I still get angry at others. I'm not always good with my spouse. I know what I should do, but I don't do it. Sometimes I'm in the waiting in the grocery line and I get impatient. And I murder someone in my head. That was me yesterday. And so Paul is saying, don't think like that. This is how to live the life of the overcomer. Ephesians 4:18, it goes on. It says, these to be thinking in that futility is because they were darkened in their understanding. They were darkened in their understanding. J.B. Phillips is a guy that wrote a commentary on this. I love what he said. It's to be blindfolded in illusion. The Greek actually brings it out that they were blind and they were deceived spiritually. In other words, outside of Christ, you do not have the ability to think clearly. You will be deceived. Jeremiah 17:9 says, your heart is wicked, my heart is wicked, it is evil, it is deceptive. Who can know it? Outside of Christ, outside of the new creation, that new part of who you really are, is just deception and darkness. And Paul is trying to get to a point here. He's trying to get to the point, to the Ephesians church, guys, you're doing all these things. You do sin. You still do things you shouldn't be doing. It's because there's an old you, but there is a way to live in the new you, to think from above. Remember, you are born again. You are born from above. Your citizenship is in heaven. Philippians 3:10. And that's where you eagerly await the return of your Savior, the King. So you may live down here. You may experience tribulation down here, all the problems of life, just like everyone else does. But you're really from heaven. And that's how God the Father sees you. So he sees you in this new creation. And so Paul is saying, start to think with God about who you are. He goes on to say this, verse 18. They've been excluded from the life of God because of their ignorance that is in them, because of the hardness of their heart, and because there's no life of God in them, no relationship with Christ, the unsaved have become callous. They've given themselves over to sensuality for the practice of every kind of impurity with greediness. And I could go on and on and on with that, and we could talk hours about how bad the world is, and oh my goodness, those Republicans and those Democrats and the donkeys and the... anyway, we're not going to do that. Paul's point isn't to show how bad the world is, and it is bad. It is gaining, it's gone out of control completely, and it's going to get worse, and it will get worse, and it will get worse. But there's a group of people on this planet that are brand new. You and me. People in other churches gathering right now. All around the world, there's a group of people that are on display. You ever thought of yourself as a trophy of grace that's on display? And God is allowing you to experience certain things because just like other people, you will have tribulation in this world. Things that are not pleasant. But as you go through them, now thinking with Jesus, suddenly he puts you on display. This is what I want to do for you. This is why you're in this situation. I'm going to use you to prove that I exist. An incredible thing. So he says this. Verse 20, but you did not learn Christ this way. In other words, something happened to you. You are brand new, and Jesus says, I'm going to help you no matter what the situation is, because you're brand new. You did not learn Christ this way. And then he goes on to say this. Verse 24. He says, put on the new self, which is in likeness of God, that has been created in righteousness and holiness of the truth. There's a new you. There's an old you, but there's a new you. Put the new you on. In other words, we can put off the old self, we can put on the new self. I mentioned this before we went away in Florida, but there was a place in England where I was growing up called Morden. If you've ever been to Morden, that's a nice place, bit of a seaside town. But there's an area of ground for about a mile and a half that's just pure mud. It's always mud, all year round. They call them the mud flats of Morden, and people do silly things there, like you have races from one end to the other. You get completely covered in mud. I fell in those mud flats. My clothes got completely filthy, and I was in an area, though, where you weren't supposed to go, and so I was being sucked down. Pretty dangerous. My friend pulled me out. My friend hadn't pulled me out, I wouldn't be here today. I thank God for my friend, and Jesus is that friend. Every time we are tempted, or we get into these cycles of depression, or anxiety, or anger, or hatred, or jealousy, every time we get into cycles of patterns of sins and lusts, all kinds of stuff that come out of us from our old nature, Jesus wants to pull us out of the mudflats. Now, I was wearing sneakers at the time, running shoes, that were completely filthy from the mud. I had to put on cleaned sneakers. Now, I didn't have my Nikes. But this is the principle. Paul is saying, guys, you don't have to be who you think you are in your weakness and your flesh. You are not your sin. You are not your failure. You are not even remotely who you think you are. Look to Jesus, the author and finisher of your faith. Look to him and you'll discover who you really are. If you've received Christ as Savior, you're completely brand new. You have a new nature. Put on the Nikes. Be an overcomer. Learn how to overcome the world, your own world as well as the world around you. Now, Paul has kind of talked about this. So verses 20 through 21, I'm going to cut this all down. But he talks about this contrast between the old and the new. Think with the new. He's talked about this before. He's talked about the old nature and the new nature back in Ephesians chapter 2. Verse 1, he said, before you knew Jesus, he said, you were dead in your trespasses and sins. You were dead, spiritually dead. You were physically alive, doing good things, probably enjoying ice cream and whatever, playing a round of golf, but you were still dead, spiritually speaking. Verse 3 in Ephesians 2, he gives the contrast. Verse 4, he says, but God, being rich in mercy, because of his great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our transgressions, made us alive together with Christ. It's by grace you've been saved. You were dead, and then the contrast is, but you were raised. You were made alive. So you were dead, but now you're alive. Do you feel alive? Do you spring out of bed in the morning and say, good morning, God? Most of the time I spring out of the bed slowly. Oh, good God, it's morning. You know, that's my old nature. But my new nature is God is going to give the victory through this situation. I don't know how he's going to do it. I don't know what he's going to do. But I'm on an assignment here, and he's got me. Isaiah 41:10, he will hold me by my right arm and he will strengthen me. He will get you through whatever it is that you have ahead this week because you're brand new in Christ. It's as simple as that. Verse 10 in Ephesians 2. Actually, no, let's read the rest of verse 4 in Ephesians 2. This is the new you, by the way. This is who you really are. This is the real you. Because of his great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in transgressions, he made us alive together. You've been saved by grace. And he raised us up with him and seated us in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. That's the real you. That's where you really are. You've been born from above. You are seated above. You're in heavenly places. That's where God sees you right now. You may see yourself stuck in a chair in front of a boring message, trying to stay awake. You may see yourself go into different things this week that are going to be tough, challenging, mundane, whatever it is. But God sees you in heaven, and he has you here on an assignment. You're a trophy of grace. You're on display. People are seeing Christ when they see you. They see that new creation. And God is saying, that's what he wants us to see as well. We need to put on our Nike shoes. Goes on in Ephesians 2 verse 10, this is the result of that, is that we are his workmanship created in Christ Jesus for good works which God prepared beforehand in eternity past that we should walk in. In other words, the things that we experience down here while we have tribulation, these things are actually good works that we walk in. It's not that we do good works. We can't be saved by good works. But there are good works that God gives us to do once we're saved, and they're His works. And a lot of those good works, you may not be thinking they're good. Oh my goodness. I gotta go and spend time with my mother-in-law this week. All right, we won't go any further than that. By the way, do you know why Peter denied Jesus? He did it 3 times. Well, it's because Jesus, 2 chapters before, healed Peter's mother-in-law. But anyway, I'm sure that's not theologically accurate, but... So there is a new you, there is an old you. Now, in the Old Testament, salvation was actually the same way. Sometimes we get a bit muddy on this, but the Old Testament reveals that salvation is by faith. The just shall live by faith, we're told in Habakkuk 1:3. So in the book of Ezekiel, God says, when I save my people, this is what I'm going to do. This is Ezekiel chapter 36, verse 26. He says, moreover, I will give them a new heart, and I will put a new spirit within them. I will remove the heart of stone, and I will give them a heart of flesh. In other words, He's going to give them a brand new heart. That's exactly what's happened. The moment you become a Christian, you get given a brand new heart. It goes on. Verse 27, I will put my spirit within them and cause them to walk in my ways. When you become a Christian, the Holy Spirit comes to live on the inside of you. You're brand new because you have someone living on the inside of you that makes you brand new. You've been brand new, washed by the blood of Christ, forgiven, and then redeemed and indwelt by the Spirit. And as we get to the end of this chapter, we'll see next week that you are sealed by the Spirit. You can't lose what He's given you because it's all Him. It's nothing to do with you. You've entered into His life. He didn't enter into your life. And because you entered into His life, He has you on display. He wants to reveal Himself to people around you, and He's going to use you to do it. You have a brand new heart. Ephesians 4:24. Paul says, put on the Lord Jesus Christ. Put off the old you, put on the new you. That's the basics of Christianity. When you get out of bed in the morning, just like you put your clothes on, you know, you take your pajamas off, put on your new clothes, because it's embarrassing if you go to work in your pajamas or the grocery store. You put on new clothes. Same thing spiritually. Lord, I'm sorry. I've been thinking stupid thoughts here. Please forgive me, cleanse me. You're faithful and just to forgive me and cleanse me of all unrighteousness. 1 John 1:9. You just confess. And then He renews your mind. He puts on the new man. In Colossians, Paul says the same thing. Colossians chapter 3, verses 1 through 3, he talks about the old you and the new you. He says in verse 3, you have died. This is the language that Paul is using. You're dead. Remember, he said that in Ephesians 2, you were dead, now you're alive. Here in Colossians, he says, you died. And then in verse 1, he says, you have been raised. Raised, that's death and resurrection. Now, we just celebrated Easter. The death and resurrection of Jesus Christ was your death and resurrection, my death and resurrection. When we become a Christian, there is this incredible uniting with the Lord Jesus. It's a mystery. That's what Paul calls it. You've been dead. You were buried, and you were raised with Christ. Let's jump to Romans chapter 6, and I'm jumping all around here for you, so try not to get too confused. But hopefully this will help you understand what it is to be a new creation. Romans 6, verse 2, Paul says this, and he goes even further than what he did in Ephesians chapter 2, and Ephesians chapter 4, and Colossians chapter 3. He says this, we died to sin. Not just that you died, you died to sin. I can't get my brain around that because I still sin. Then verse 4, he says, we have been buried with Christ. Then verse 5, he says, because we're united in the likeness of His death, we should also be in the likeness of His resurrection. You died, you were buried, and you were raised with Christ. So the old you is gone. The old you is in the grave. The old you is gone. The brand new you is resurrected. You are alive with Christ. You are seated above in heavenly places. And this is why we are told to fix our eyes upon Jesus. the author and finisher of our faith, to think with God. Every situation you go into, what does the Bible say? Oh, Lord, I can feel my emotions getting here. I'm getting angry. Oh, help me, Lord. If you're in the book every single day, you open this book, the Bible, and you take just one promise, chew on it, meditate upon it, ask God to help you understand it. Without his help, you won't. But he will if you ask him. And as you do that, he gives you wisdom. Anyone that lacks wisdom, let him ask God who gives freely, James 1:17. He'll give you wisdom for the situation. And that will bring you into the situation with the new you, not the old you. Put on the real you. He goes on to say this, verse 8, and sums it up. He says, if we have died with Christ, we believe we shall also live with him. In verse 11, so therefore, consider yourselves dead to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus. Now that's the reality. That is what we would call justification. You heard that theological word. Justification is what happened legally the moment you became a Christian. Because of the finished work of Christ on the cross, he completed the work. The moment you, years later, said yes to Jesus, he says, all right, you're entering into my life. Legally, here's a contract. You've been justified. It's just as if you never sinned. We talked about the covenant at Easter Sunday, a covenant that God makes with us. He shed his blood in Jeremiah 31:31. It's a new covenant. In Luke 22:20, he says, this is the blood of the new covenant shed for you, shed for the sins of many. Drink this in remembrance of me. Disciples had no idea what he was talking about. But for you and for me, that new covenant that Jesus was making with you and me meant that he was making us brand new creations. It's not just that you become a better person when you become a Christian. You don't. You become a completely different person. Now, you still have the old person you're lugging around, but God has made you completely new. You're fit for heaven. Whether you think you are or not, God already declares you are justified. Then the rest, the outside stuff, where we have to start choosing to put on Christ, to think with God, that is what we call, another big theological word, sanctification. In other words, I've got to every single day choose to put on my Nikes, tie up my shoelaces, get ready, and then run with the Lord into the day. If I don't choose to do that, yeah, I'm going to fall flat back into the mud flat. Now, there is a verse that we missed in Ephesians 4. It's the hinge on which this door swings. It's verse 23. Verse 23. It says, be renewed in the spirit of your mind. Be renewed in the spirit of your mind. This is a fascinating phrase. It's an iterative aorist in the Greek, and that's just long words, isn't it? But it means it's something that's happening at present and will continue to happen. In other words, you've got to choose every single moment to be renewed. It's not something you do as soon as you put on your Nikes in the morning. Okay, I'm a winner, I'm an overcomer. Step out the door. Flat on your face as the UPS guy comes around the corner too fast. Hey! You're yelling at him. Problem is, we have these bodies of sin and death. We have to choose to keep putting on Christ. So we have to choose to open up the Bible, read the Word of God, just even if it's a five-minute devotional, every single day. As you do that and you ask the Lord to help you through His Spirit, your mind is renewed. It's Romans 12. You're renewed in the spirit of your thinking and the spirit of your mind. He starts to change you. You become more and more and more like Jesus. The more you do this, it's not that you become sinless, you just sin less. But you become more like Christ. You become conformed to his image. You're a trophy of grace. You go to work. People know what you're like. But over time, they start to see a difference in you. He's a Christian, isn't he? How? I know what he's going through. Why has he had so much joy and peace? I don't get it. I've got to find out more. Well, it's because the guy's in this book. He's talking to God, his creator. He has a relationship with him. He's born from above. Brand new. You're not who you think you are. And you're not in that job or in that situation or with those people doing recreational fun hobbies because of who you are outside of Christ. It's because of who you are in Christ. He wants to put you on display. Now we have a problem. We've got this thing called justification. So you are raised with Christ. God sees you already in heaven. You have this ongoing sanctification. You're still down here struggling with sin. How do we become overcomers? Well, Paul says this. This is amazing. Romans chapter 7. He's already given us Romans chapter 6, which is just like Ephesians 4. There's an old you and there's a new you, and this is what happens day to day. Romans 7, this is his personal testimony. You would think the Apostle Paul, you know, would be saying, I have a great life, I'm full of the Spirit, and I always do the right thing. I'm an amazing Christian. No, this is his testimony. Romans 7, 14, he says, look, I know the law is spiritual, and I know, in other words, I'm to obey God. But I am of the flesh. I'm sold into sin, a slave to sin. I don't know what I'm doing. On the one hand, I know in my head I should walk with Jesus, yet I keep finding myself not walking with Jesus. I don't like this. I don't know how to overcome this. I keep doing the very thing I do not want to do. Then he goes on, verse 17. So now, no longer am I the one doing it, but it is sin that dwells within me. This is really hard to grasp. But he's saying that sin is dwelling within him. And interestingly enough, he does not locate sin in the new person, in who you really are. It's in who you used to be. This is what he says. Verse 18, I know nothing good dwells in me, that is my flesh, nothing. And so I do the very thing I do not want to do, and I no longer seem to be the one who is doing it, though. He's saying there's a part of him that still does these things, but the more he presses in to who he really is, the less he does it. And it's a frustrating struggle. It's an ongoing battle. You will always struggle with sin this side of heaven. In this world, you will have tribulation, but be of good cheer, for I have overcome the world. Paul is wanting to get the Ephesians church and you and I to learn how to walk in unison with Jesus. And the more we open the Bible, the more we pray, the more we get into situations that are just awful, he reveals himself and he teaches us how to become overcomers. How to put on our Nikes. Galatians 2:20 says, I am crucified with Christ. That's the old me gone. Crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. This is the new me. Yet not I. It's nothing to do with me. It's Jesus. But Christ who lives within me. Christ lives within you. He's your hope of glory. And the life that I now live, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. So here we go. Verse 24. This is Paul's final words on the situation. This is personal testimony. He says this. O wretched man that I am, who will set me free from this body of sin and death? Who's going to set me free? Now we know. He's going to say who's going to set him free. It will be Jesus. He's alluding to something, though, that's an ongoing battle. Every single one of us faces this every single day. None of us are perfect. We all sin. 1 John 3:18 says that, you know, if anyone says they are without sin, then they're a liar. Every single one of us sins because we have this body of sin and death. And he's alluding to a practice that took place during the time that he was alive. The Romans, when they would take a prisoner, especially a murderer, someone that had a high-ranking crime, they would throw him in the prison along with the corpse of the person they had murdered or the corpse of the previous prisoner. They would then attach them to the back of the prisoner. Now, in some cases, if they were really mean, and this is kind of disgusting, they would actually sew that dead corpse to the back of the person in prison. And of course, as the day went on, eventually that decaying corpse would enter into the body of the person who was alive. They would both be driven towards death. And that's what Paul is saying. This is what it's like. This is what it feels like. I'm struggling with this sin, and I feel just like that situation. But then he says this. Verse 25, it says, but thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord gives the victory. You won't stay in the prison. There is a victory, but thanks be to Jesus Christ. He's the one that's overcome the world. He's the one that's overcome the situations in your life. He's the one that's going to overcome the depression, the anxiety, the financial issues, the sickness. Anything that's going on, he's the one that's going to uphold you and strengthen you and keep you going. You just have to put on Christ. Keep putting off the old you. Keep putting on the real you. Put on Christ. When you're angry, put on Christ. Grab a verse from the Bible. Remember who you are. Put on the real you. That's what Paul is saying. Otherwise, you're going to be struggling and struggling and struggling. Put on the new you. He ends it with Romans 8, verse 1. And he shouts this out. He says, there is therefore no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. You're feeling a little condemned, feeling a little ashamed of your sins or your past. You feel guilt. Jesus has already paid for that at the cross. No condemnation for those who are in Christ, because all the condemnation was poured out upon Jesus at the cross. Full wrath of God the Father was poured out upon Jesus, so it wouldn't be poured out upon you. Because now you are united to Christ himself. New creation. I'm going to close with this. 1 Corinthians 15. Paul speaks about the resurrected body. There's a time coming where you will no longer struggle with sin. You will no longer struggle with your old sin nature. There's justification. Legally, you're already in heaven. God sees you there, seated above with Christ in heavenly places. Sanctification, though, means that you're still down here struggling with sin, trying to work this life out, figure things out. But there's coming a time where we will see a thing called glorification. You will get to heaven. One day you will be there. It's an incredible thing. Last week, a friend of mine, he was one of my professors, and he was the pastor of the church I attended while I was in seminary. You may have heard of him, Charles Stanley. He graduated with honors, and he's now in heaven. No more struggle with sin. No more struggle with sin. No more pain. No more death. He's graduated with honors. He's discovered who he really is. He's put on the real him, and now he's there. Our friend Garth, dear brother. The real Garth is smiling in heaven right now. He passed away. He's no longer with us last week. And yet, no more struggle with sin. He doesn't have to say, oh, wretched man that I am. Instead, he says, oh, joyful man that I am. And he's looking forward to the time when he gets to see each one of us. Same experience. There's a future glorification coming. And Paul says this in 1 Corinthians 15. Verse 23, he says, we eagerly await the redemption of our body. We're going to be in heaven soon. In the meantime, we have to keep on putting on Christ, putting off the old me, putting on the new me, the real me. Paul says, as we do this, there's a time coming where we will catch glimpses of who we really are in heaven now. Right now. I don't know what it is you're facing this week, but God wants to help you put on the Nike shoes. Be a winner. Be an overcomer. Now, Paul goes a little bit further. Closing verse. Romans 8, verse 34. He says, in all these things that you're facing, including your own issues, in all these things, you are more than conquerors. More than overcomers. In other words, in the Greek, it's not just you're a Nike, not just wearing Nike shoes, you're wearing Nike clothes. You're more than a conqueror, more than an overcomer. It's hooper Nike in the Greek. It means like a superhero. Just the ability that you have to rise above this world is in Christ. He's the one that has overcome everything. He's the one that won the victory at the cross, and he's the one that will win the victory no matter what is you're facing this week. You're more than a conqueror because of Christ and what he's done for you. As we go through this week, let's put off the old way of thinking. Let's put on the new way of thinking. Whatever thing you face, whatever situation, take a deep breath. Look up to the Lord. Okay, God, give me a verse from the Bible. And if I can't think of a verse, Lord, remind me of your goodness. Latch hold of him. Put on the new you, the real you. Amen. Let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you, Lord, that you didn't just send your son to save us from our sins, but you sent your son to put us into a relationship with you that's eternal. Help us to put off who we used to be and to live in the new creation, Lord, the real us. We pray, Lord, if there's anyone here that does not know you yet, does not have that hope that's eternal, they only have hope for tomorrow, things that are temporal, Lord, we pray, Lord, that you would speak to their hearts through your Spirit, that you would draw them and turn them towards you. We pray that they would know you as their Savior. For each of us, Lord, we pray you would lead us through the week ahead. Some of us in this room are facing some pretty heavy things, and we pray, Lord, that you would give us your strength. And Lord, we pray that you would hold us tight, lead us as only you can. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you for watching. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. by clicking the link on the upper left-hand side of your screen so you can see all of our videos when they come out. Or you can watch last Sunday's sermon by clicking the video link on the bottom left of your screen. From all of us at Sylvester Community Church, thank you and God bless.